There are times in your life that you may be faced with tough decisions. This is not one of them. It's that time, just in time for a fresh batch of cookies out of the oven. Lace up your trousers and get ready for some jokes. From Los Angeles, California, it's the Brian Crow Show. Bow, bitches.
Yes, indeed. It is time once again for the Brian Crow Show, and I am your host, Brian Crow. Thank you so much for tuning back in. I always appreciate having you here to watch, listen, learn, love, and maybe find a deep, quiet moment for yourself. More than I need to know, but thank you for offering to share. I want to welcome to the studio. My guest tonight is I met her through a friend of mine, Mr. Dr. Brian King, who has been a guest on this show previously, introduced me to this fine young lady here. Incredibly talented, multifaceted. Happy to welcome to the studio, Sanjini. Thank you so much for coming out.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
And I had the privilege of meeting you on the 4th of July.
Yes, we actually got to watch things blow up in the sky. It was amazing.
Amazing fireworks.
Yeah, exactly. It was cool. We were down by Venice Beach going, can you see that? It's behind a palm tree.
A palm tree caught on fire.
Yeah, and then I was going to say, wait a minute, that palm tree's on fire. That's not a fire. That's an actual fire in the works. It was a good time. There was a poor person had to, there was a BMW, remember that? There was a really nice BMW parked underneath that palm tree, and there was just stuff falling all over, and you're going, God, I hope he's got Geico.
And there were so many fire trucks trying to stop the palm tree from,
But enough about that guy. Let's talk about you. So, interesting history that as I've sort of looked at some of your work and sort of checked out. So you are originally from Zimbabwe.
Yes, I am. My grandparents were from India, but I was born and brought up in Zimbabwe.
Really?
Yes.
How long did you live there for?
Until I was 16, and then I came to college in the United States.
Where?
Oklahoma for 9 months, San Francisco Bay Area, and Texas.
Hold it. Put the brakes on. Zimbabwe to Oklahoma. So how did that kind of culture shock feel? At least, I'm guessing, was that a lot of culture shock?
No.
Really?
It wasn't. It was more of a culture shock. After I graduated, I moved to Vancouver, and moving to Canada was a culture shock.
Really?
Yes.
What about that was, what was sort of different about that?
I'm not used to moose and snow.
I'm not used to moose.
And Canadian,
that's a t-shirt.
And Canadian men who don't look at me. So, yeah.
I honestly know very little about Zimbabwe. What is Zimbabwe like?
It was a beautiful country growing up.
Yeah.
I haven't been back for a while, but the African landscape is beautiful. And I grew up spoiled.
Really?
So I grew up in a big house with a big garden and domestic workers. And I went to a private school.
Wow.
I kind of had a chauffeur.
kind of had a chauffeur? What, he only sort of drove?
No, well, I had a driver that took me to school or picked me up.
Me too. I called her mom.
Okay. Well, my mom and dad did that too, but we also had people that...
Yeah. Wow.
So when I moved to the United States, I had never done my laundry. I never did my bed. I never cleaned anything. I'm very neat, but I still don't know how to mop and sweep.
Well, you and me both, so we're good there. What did your parents do? That you were in Zimbabwe
Well, because a lot of my relatives in Zimbabwe are upper middle class, so my parents had a business, a clothing wholesale retail business.
Interesting.
And so that's when they sent me. I started college at 16 in the U.S.
Started college at 16.
Yes.
Did you skip a couple of grades?
Actually didn't graduate from high school.
Okay.
But I did finish. I did get my bachelor's at 20. So
impressive. What did you get your bachelor's in?
In history with a minor of mathematics.
So history, mathematics, and so now you make movies. I see the connection.
Yeah, it's a big connection. But I got my graduate degree in speech communication.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So everything's essentially communications.
Mm-hmm.
And acting in film is communicating a story.
Right.
To the audience.
So what made you want to come to the States?
It's a land of dreams and opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
And everything about it I like from the beginning. And the men are hot. And I love blondes.
Well,
I just have to say.
Thank you.
It's my weakness.
If somebody out in the studio gets...
all men but blondes.
Yeah, if somebody gets some bleach while we're on the air, I'd see an opportunity here.
Okay.
That's all I'm saying. But then what brought... So you come to Oklahoma and then you said you went to the Bay Area?
To the Bay Area for 2 months. What? I mean, 9 months.
Where was that?
In Fremont.
No, I'm from the Bay Area, so I know Fremont. I dated parts of Fremont.
Did you?
Yes.
It's sexy.
Yes. I don't know if I would describe Fremont as sexy.
Actually, it's like suburban. Every house looks alike.
Yeah, because they're all on stilts. Yeah, it's,
yeah.
Is your home mobile too? Yes, it is, Fred. Thank you.
Yeah. I actually got accepted to go to San Francisco State.
Oh, yeah?
But I chose to go to Lonely College. And then I got accepted to go to UC Berkeley.
Uh-huh.
And I decided to go to University of Texas. So everything's big.
I could go to Berkeley, but I went to Texas. So you've really bounced around the globe.
I have. And I lived in Miami, Toronto, Vancouver. Yeah.
I feel like we need a map with like some like tacks in it going, Sanjini was here, Sanjini was here. And then and so what about all that then brought you up to Canada?
It was just easier for me to get my residency in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So
got you.
That's why.
And so how out of all of that did where did filmmaking come from? I mean, because it sounds like a very interesting sort of experience and based on the schooling that you're doing. Where did making movies come into that for you?
Okay. I wanted to be an actress since I was really young.
Mm-hmm.
But in high school in Zimbabwe, in junior school, I did a lot of plays and theater. But my high school was new, so we didn't have performing arts. So when I went to college, I didn't think that I could study film.
Mm-hmm.
But it was when I got into some trouble. And
there's a story there.
And I was given... some volunteer work to do, and they gave me two places.
Some volunteer work or what?
The Performing Arts Center, the Arts Center.
Mm-hmm.
So I chose performing arts. And so once I started volunteering, I wasn't afraid to pick up the phone and call an acting coach. And that's when I started doing plays and taking lessons and just everything about films.
So sort of happenstance that you began to discover sort of the theatrical performing aspect of things?
Yes. And I knew that that's what I've always liked.
What about it did you like? What moved you that way?
I like being expressive and being creative and like... I think we've all lived different lives, different, in past lives, we were different people.
Mm-hmm.
And we've lived in different... just with my life personally, I like to go from one extreme to the other. Like sometimes I've had Sabbath with an Orthodox Jewish family on a Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
Then I've gone out and had a crazy time in South Beach.
Okay.
At a crazy nightclub.
At that point, I had Orthodox...
So it's like, you know, going from one extreme to the other.
I had Orthodox dinner one night and did a pipe bombing the next time.
So, yeah. And that's what acting is.
Mm-hmm.
There's very few professions where you can say, fuck you. You could do that in theater and film,
mm-hmm.
and it's okay.
I do it at work all the time.
Okay, and you,
yeah,
well, entertainment, music, radio, but most people don't get that privilege.
Right.
So, in a bank. Or...
at least not without bad repercussions.
Yes.
He said, fuck you again. He's out of here.
It's true.
Yeah.
It's true. So...
so one of the latest things that I saw that you did, I want to have people be able to see some of the work that you've done. You've got an action film in two parts, and we'll get into the specifics of that. But it's called Eye of the Empress. And what it's about, what, 20 to 25 minutes long? Yeah?
Maybe altogether. The mm-hmm. first part is about 8 minutes, a second 10.
Mm-hmm.
What so, yeah.
Jason, Mr. Producer, let's go ahead and roll a few minutes of part one of Eye of the Empress, and then we'll talk a bit about what's up there on the screen. I checked this out. It's a little bit of badass. Check it out. This is Eye of the Empress. Part one.
Hola, senor. Housekeeping.
Who asked for you?
El chico malo.
Okay. Go ahead.
Gracias, senor.
Yeah, I'm checking on the cleaning lady. Shit. Hey, woman, come back!
Jason, probably won't do the entire, probably won't do this entire piece, but at some point I'll just go, we'll cut it. And, but not for a bit. There's more fun to be had. We're definitely going to get through like some of the, yeah.
Drop the gun.
The Empress. So now that we're all here, let's introduce ourselves.
Brad. Street Fighter.
Valdivia. The Black Belt.
Saint-Pierre, the Gymnast.
Big Z. I don't have any specialties.
My name is Skylar. Where's the Empress?
I can tell you it's not on tour.
Miraculously disappeared from the biggest museum in Mexico City.
Why is it important to you?
Let me fix myself up before I kill you.
Some family token.
Do you have GPS?
But I was watching it. I was watching going, that's so funny. That's like...
Smartphone.
Excuse me, be with you in a moment.
There. Yeah.
want the hottest substance GPS.
So for the record, I'm going to be really careful now about any questions that I ask my guest for the rest of the night.
Okay, I love fighting men. Dude. I like doing other things with them too, but I love fighting them. Oh yeah.
So that was that was great stuff. So you wrote, produced, and directed that, correct?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. You're not quite doing enough.
No, I'm not. I have to do everything. It's really tough. But I think the more I do, the better my movies seem to look. And I seem to get more help. And
so obviously, without giving anything away, so number one, it is a film out on YouTube. It can be found. It's in two parts. Now, is it in two parts for any specific reason? Was it a matter of budgeting? And so we'll get part one done, and then we'll get budgeting, we'll get part two?
It was budgeting.
Yeah?
Yes.
Well, the nice thing about it, having watched all of it, it had, and the whole thing to me sort of has a, sort of like the younger niece of Kill Bill.
Yes. Yeah. It's supposed to be, I like Quentin Tarantino's style.
I was going
to
ask you that.
And also Robert Rodriguez's Once Upon a Time in Mexico.
Yes.
And then I especially like Sergio Leone's spaghetti westerns. So it's got that western feel.
Completely. In fact, the opening shot of the of your eyes, very Sergio Leone. Very yes. much. Yeah. I was waiting for that. Wah, wah, wah. Yeah, it was just, yeah, I totally get that.
And I like the, and it was shot in East Los Angeles, so I like the landscape of East LA. It's got a very western feel to it. And I shot at my friend's scrap, you know, where there's a lot of trucks and scrapyard. Scrapyard full of.
So the guys you were fighting with, where did you find them?
I had an audition. And so I chose these guys.
Because they all had some martial arts skill, as do you.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Yes. I've been taking Shaolin Kempo martial arts.
Really?
Yes. And I just got my black belt at the Shaolin Temple in China a year ago.
Okay, so wait, wind that back. You got your black belt at the Shaolin Temple in China.
Yes. Actually, I take martial arts in Vancouver and Beverly Hills, and
that's quite a commute.
Yes, it is a commute. So they sometimes make a trip to China. We actually got to do the test in the Shaolin Temple.
No way.
And it was midnight. So it was hot.
That's amazing. I've always wanted to go to China and go to the Shaolin Temple and practice. I took Kung Fu Sun Tzu years ago, and I've always wanted to get back into that. And one of my sort of, I don't have much of a bucket list. I have more of like a cup it list, just a small cup of ideas.
Okay.
But on there is practicing martial arts at the Shaolin Temple. That's amazing. What was that like?
It was amazing. Actually, in the morning we had to get up early, and we had a big ceremony. With the abbot, he looked, and the Shaolin monks did a demonstration for us. So the abbot would call out like an animal, praying mantis, and a monk would come out and do like a praying mantis form, or a snake, or a tiger, or you know, there's
right.
And then they gave us our certificates. So people had different belt levels, and the abbot was there to kind of. You know, while I got my black belt certificate, the abbot was there. He looked a little bit bored, but
somebody else doing kicks. Oh, enough!
I know. And then I got to train with the Shaolin monks.
Really?
Yes. So I had there were like about 25 of them, and I had two Shaolin monks that trained my little group. And then I got to meet them in downtown Los Angeles, too, the same monks.
You're really big on commuting. That's
yes, I know. And but I want to make a big movie one day about with the Shaolin monks at the Shaolin Temple and in Shanghai. And I'm going to have the actual Shaolin monks in my movie.
That'd be great. What would that be about?
I'm going to seduce a monk. Seriously.
So it's about sacrilege.
No, like a, you know.
I'm just curious that when a Shaolin monk says no, does he like kick you across the room?
They're shy.
So how long did you spend up at the temple?
About like a week, I'm not sure, 10 days. Yeah. And then because we were in Beijing and other places too, and Shanghai. The Shaolin Temple is in, it's close to Denfeng.
Sure.
And then I was in Cambodia and Thailand, just visiting.
Just like, again, we need a map with just X's on it.
Yes, I know.
That's amazing. What does it feel like to have been to, I mean, I don't know many people that have been to as many places as you've been. How has that shaped your overall sort of worldview?
You know, it's only up till now, but when I was 20, I thought everyone had my life. Mm-hmm. And I thought that my life was like normal for everyone. But by the time I was 20, I'd gone to 20 countries and I'd lived in many cities and I already had my degree and I had my freedom for 4 years. And I was used to like taking off going to Hawaii or Belize or Jamaica or... Believe it or not, I travel without that much money. I don't know. I'm just lucky when I travel.
Is that what you call it?
What?
Nothing.
Yes, it's lucky. Like I had a free ticket I had to use because I complained to American Airlines a year ago. So I went to Ecuador in April. And then I have a friend in Guayaquil. So she wanted me to stay there for weeks.
Wow.
So it's just like, you know, I'm just wherever I go.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing. How long did you have to study to get your black belt?
7-8 years.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And so was that something in putting together to go back to the film and doing Eye of the Empress, was it something that you were intentionally going, all right, I've been doing this, I've studied this, let me find a way to put it on film?
Yes, because primarily why I take martial arts is to give me an extra skill for film.
Mm-hmm.
I don't take it for self-defense because I've never needed to defend myself.
Mm-hmm. But in the event of...
No, because... I don't know. Guys are scared of me. I don't know. I weigh 93 pounds. And
it's a terrifying 93, though.
Yes. It's, you'd be surprised.
Yes.
A government officials, authority, 6'5" guys, they're scared of me.
Well, I guess that's not a bad thing, I suppose. If you're gonna intimidate people, government officials, certainly not a bad thing. The IRS shows up at your door going, we'd like to audit your... No, we've changed our minds. We realize you're a 93-pound terror. So, yes.
You'd be surprised. So, I take martial arts because martial arts is an art and a sport.
Mm-hmm.
And in my system, there's 5 animals. And so it's just, I like the aesthetics of the way it looks on camera.
No, I agree. Shaolin, also like Wushu, which is very much a lot of sort of the flying acrobatic stuff, ideally without a wire, but, you know, that always works too. There is a visual appeal to it that I think works on camera better than other stuff.
I wish I could do the acrobatic stuff, but I'm not as flexible.
That's why you wear a wire and you get just, they fly around, so you become a human kite. There she goes. Yeah.
I think it's like training at the gym with weights, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
I need to stretch a lot more.
So how long did it take you to do both parts of Eye of the Empress?
It took me a while because I did Eye of the Empress Part 1 a year ago, and this year Eye of the Empress Part 2, but also did an art model film. So, and I have so many other projects.
Mm-hmm. What other projects?
I have like a comedy sitcom called Motel Patel.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's based on an Indian family who run a motel with the different characters. And then I have a Shaolin Monk treatment. I have an animated script called Beverly Hills Skunk that I've written. It's about a skunk on the most wanted list in Beverly Hills. So.
What studio does he work for? No. So you were also talking about... other films that you've done, and there on your YouTube channel, there's what you call sort of a dramatic scene.
Yes.
And I thought it'd be interesting to show that because it's such a complete polar opposite to the action film. Let's go ahead and look at that and talk about it because there's an interesting dynamic going on, and I'm wondering about the personal level of it. Do we have that pulled up to
Father and Daughter?
That's the one. Let's go ahead and this is a dramatic scene featuring Miss Sanjini. Take a look at this. There's no guns.
You are not a businesswoman.
I will make money and be successful.
I provided you with the best education. If you haven't made money acting yet, then you need to get a job with a regular company. You need to start from the bottom and get some experience.
I have worked at the bottom doing extra work.
But you need a stable income. You need to get a regular job.
My dreams will become reality. I will be an actress and producer. You'll see.
2 years ago.
Your mother and I went to see a psychologist.
I was, I'm going to say, I agree. I was like, you look like you're 12.
A lot of people say, I like my life.
And I don't need help. And if you want me to see a therapist, then she'd better not be female, because I refuse to talk to women. Don't you understand? I'm not a 9-to-5 kind of person. I'm creative, and I'm a free spirit, and I will reach my dreams. Just be patient.
I also think somewhere, it's especially compared to where the lighting and sort of where you're sitting is compared
to the
actor playing your father.
I
mean, it just looks more imposing.
We don't want you to struggle.
Because when they show
I know you're worried about me.
When I show friends, they said the same.
But I will make you proud of me. You'll see. I love you.
We love you too. We just don't want you to struggle.
All right. And scene.
Okay.
All right, so what's the deal? You look like you're 12 in that. Well, how long ago did that get shot?
That was like 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Now, it's interesting because you look, I mean, just whether it was the lighting or the angle, you look much smaller and demure as compared to the positioning of where the actor playing your father. So there was something almost, I wouldn't say belittling, but you just look much like this was like a while ago. Not that you look old now or anything.
No.
You look so old now. What happened?
No, what happened is, no, when it came out, all my friends were saying, you look so young in that. It's something about it. Maybe it's just that role of being the daughter makes me, it's like made me feel young.
So something
does it make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Something about that whole thing that seemed very personal. Is that something that was, I mean, obviously you wrote it. I'm guessing it wasn't something that you just sort of pulled. I wonder what it'd be like if there was a daughter and she was having something going on. But where did that come from?
A lot of my stories are based on my experiences. Mm-hmm. So, like, even if I, which I will be making films about other places in the world, it's because I've been to those places. Mm-hmm. I don't even have to do research.
So all of your traveling, you're really just location scouting.
Well, I've had so many experiences, so, you know, I guess I tell stories about what's personal for me.
Mm-hmm.
And it is based on my relationship with my father.
Yeah?
And he won't watch the movie.
He won't?
No.
Really? Why?
He won't watch or see anything I do unless it makes money.
So. Well, all right, so wait a minute. So if after the interview I give you $1 for each scene, can you call your dad and go, hey, I made a couple of bucks. Will you watch my work now?
Yeah, then he will.
All right, cool, deal, fine. I'll pay for your dad to watch
and
your work.
And he actually did send me to therapy.
Did he?
Yes.
How did that work out?
You
made a movie with guns and fighting. I see.
Well, the therapist didn't think that I had a problem. And at the end of 3 months, he was really sad to, you know, that I was leaving.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was because every day I have different stories. And you know, I didn't go in there depressed like most. You know, the stories I have to hear with people are so depressed.
Right.
And it's kind of the reason why I think I have, like, I know, I've been around over 20 Shaolin monks. I know over 20, 25 plus Catholic nuns personally.
Did they ever get in a room and fight? I'd love to see that.
No, but maybe I'll put them in my movie. Yeah,
exactly.
actually, in the second part of my Eye of the Empress, I am in the nun's outfit and I fight. And my mom liked that outfit the most.
Did she?
Yes, she did.
Because you're so covered up. That's so great, darling.
Oh, she loves that. Yeah. She loves that. And then I know Indian priest. He texted me something from England the other day.
Mm-hmm.
Rabbis. These people like me a lot. I don't know why. These spiritual people. Why am I discussing this? I forget.
We were talking about the, this was a tangent off of the idea of having 20 monks and a bunch of nuns all in a room fighting.
Okay, okay.
And not over something spiritual, just like duking it out. But,
yes, I think it's because I add color to their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So when I went to see that psychologist, I added color to his life.
Mm-hmm.
Because all day long they're listening to people with problems. And that's why I think nuns like me, because I'm an actress. They know I don't know how to sweep properly. You know, they'll give me other creative things to do. Or, yeah.
So how is your relationship with your dad? I mean, he won't watch your work. Is he at least on some level supportive of it? I won't look at it, but it's okay with me?
My dad and I are very similar.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't want to admit that we both have the same blood type. And there's no one else closely related to him right now, because his parents are not alive, than me.
Mm-hmm.
Not my brother or sister or my mother. But I do what I like doing, mm-hmm. and I don't listen to him, so basically, yes. He's tough, but I'm tough too.
Cut from the same cloth. What does he do?
Right now he's selling his properties in Zimbabwe because they're going to be moving with my sister in Tampa.
Zimbabwe. So, you guys travel a lot.
Yes, I know.
what is your last name?
Bhakta.
And does that, it stands for I travel?
Since I was 16, my brother, sister, parents, we've been in different cities and continents always.
Really?
My brother in London, my father, parents in Zimbabwe, my sister Connecticut, or I was in Texas, or we just constantly in different places. So, and my dream is that we all are together in one place.
Yeah, at the airport, passing each other, going, "Hi, now where are you going? We're going this way. We're going here. Well, I'll see you in a few months. Bye bye."
Well, I think they can just deal with me for 1 week. I think so.
It's like a timeshare.
Yes.
Yes. You get her for 1 week. We get her for 1 week.
Yes.
How does that make you feel?
Because I'm different from the family, they're very practical,
mm-hmm.
and very grounded, and I'm not. So in many ways, I actually like having a family where there's that stability,
mm-hmm.
because my life's so crazy sometimes. But I'm used to it.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. My dad's not speaking to me right now, but he will soon.
Dad, call Sanjini. Let it go. Just a message from your friend, Brian.
Yes.
So to completely pivot off, because there are so many different, very interesting facets, let's see. We have action filmmaker, dramatic scene actress, martial artist, black belt, studied at the Shaolin Temple, and children's books.
Oh, okay, yes.
Yeah. So,
Chuck and Pony, and My Life is a Dollar Bill. This is not the Black Stallion.
That's not the Black Stallion. No, clearly not. That's,
It's.
Which one did you write first?
I wrote this one first, but I've actually written 15 other stories.
15?
Which I haven't published yet.
Mm-hmm.
And they're a lot more creative. But this one maybe rings true. It's like, it's a pony that loses its mom and home, has its adventures, but finally finds its way back home. And maybe I don't know my home sometimes.
I was going to say, gee, there's nothing that sounds a little bit personal.
Yeah, it's personal. Yes. I didn't realize it, but mm-hmm. yes.
When did you write that?
A couple of years ago, yeah. I think 2011 or 10.
Yeah. And writing a children's book is not, at least I would think, is not something people go, "Oh, I'm thinking about writing a kid's book." What made you think of writing a story and then going, "Oh, let me do this for children," as compared to saying writing a similar kind of story, probably not a pony, but for an older age?
It was my friend in Texas, mm-hmm. and my sister.
50 Shades of Pony.
Yes. Right. Oh, I am going to do a lot more films that related to sexuality, so.
I'm shocked.
I'm not sure how my books are going to sell, but my friend in Texas and my sister convinced me to write these stories, and then I just got so many other ideas and started writing more.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how.
But what made you think, let me write this for kids?
To be honest, it's not like I have children or I'm not around mothers that much.
Mm-hmm.
But I think children's stories are fun and imaginative.
Mm-hmm.
And I have an imagination and I just like fun stuff. I love animation.
Yeah.
So I love to watch animated movies.
Is there something in the story that you wanted to share with kids?
Yes.
What was that?
Just stories that are fun and entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've been to bookstores or libraries and the stories don't have, they're not as imaginative or creative.
Mm-hmm.
And also my vocabulary is a little bit tough. But I think that Americans need to improve their English a little bit more.
What do you mean?
Because many graduate from college and they cannot write a paragraph.
Right.
So.
But I guess, is there a central message to the story that you were wanting to share to maybe have?
Oh, the central message is there's no place like home.
Oh. So it's the Wizard of Oz via the Chocolate Pony.
Yes.
He's not wearing ruby slippers.
It's the Wizard of Oz story, yes.
Gotcha. And for you, is there no place like home? Or is there's no place like home and I'm not sure exactly where that is?
The U.S. is always my home in my heart.
Yeah?
Yes. Because it's where I came to school.
Mm-hmm.
And it's where I have my friends. And my parents and my sister are American. So, and most of my friends.
Gotcha.
So, yes.
And what about My Life is a Dollar Bill? Is this the most recent?
Yes, it follows a $1 bill from New York City to Disney World. And it ends up in Texas. So, I went to college in Texas, so it has to end up in Texas.
Well, that's where most dollar bills do
and
end up.
And it's like, the illustrations are very colorful.
Who did the illustrations?
A woman by the name of Kathy Kerber, who I've never met. But
really?
I had to work with her to get the things that I wanted. Like, you know, I'm very fussy, so I wanted things to be very, the illustrations to be very colorful.
Mm-hmm.
So
what made you think about writing The Pathway of a Dollar Bill? Is there a financial spending component?
You know, it maybe, I didn't know why, but now that I think of it, it's related. I dedicate this to my parents and especially my father.
Mm-hmm.
So it's...
Pattern.
Yes, it's a pattern. So it's to teach children the value of a dollar,
mm-hmm.
and every dollar counts. And maybe it's my way of, like, value. I know how to spend money, but I'm learning how to make money.
Yeah, I got the first part of that down.
How to make money?
No, spending.
Oh, okay. I know how to spend money really well.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yours or other people's?
My father. My father might say his.
Yes.
So.
And so you wrote these and I know that they're available on Amazon, but how did you ever go through sort of like a methodology of publicizing this? Are they selling well? Do people know it's out there?
People will know it's out there now.
Yes.
It's on the show. It's on Amazon, mm-hmm. Amazon in Canada and UK, BarnesandNobles.com,
mm-hmm.
and AuthorHouse.com, and it's also in digital format.
Gotcha.
So it can be downloaded on iTunes or Kindle for like $3.99 or something in a minute. So
it's amazing. It's such a I was just amazed as I was looking at all the different things that you do. I mean, again, to go from I'm shooting guns, I'm kicking ass, and oh by the way, let me tell you a nice story.
Oh wait till you use the next film that I just finished.
Right.
That's completely
different.
Yes.
We're going into the NC-17 mode.
Yes.
Yeah, so we will pivot off of this to how would you describe your art film?
It's also based on my experiences. Uh-huh. I worked as an art model in Vancouver,
mm-hmm.
for many years, so it was based on my experiences and maybe a tribute or way to say bye to that.
Really?
Because I like it. It's creative, but at some point I get bored easily.
Do you?
Yes.
Well, good. The show's almost over.
No, I'm not bored with you.
Mr. Producer, let's go ahead and play the what is the title of this? I'm sorry, I'm drawing a blank.
It's a Portrait of a Nude Art Model.
Portrait of a Nude Art Model.
And it's all of it is based on my stories. I mean, exactly like my experiences, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So go ahead and let's roll this and we will discuss it following. Enjoy.
Okay. Artists draw models in a Rubenesque fashion, with lots of fat and love handles. I weigh 93 pounds. How many love handles do I have?
I think that most artists project themselves on the paper, so they just draw an extension of themselves.
Artists should capture the essence of beauty, not distort it. This 92-year-old woman called Ingborg, who could barely function, has splattered drawings of me on the internet, except you cannot recognize me because she made me look 92 years old.
Maybe her eyesight was not good.
I must have been Aphrodite or Venus in a past life. The archetype of feminine beauty, love, and sexual desire. Except men don't want to marry me because I don't look like their mothers. And so I'm just an object of desire and fantasy, not the girlfriend or housewife.
You need to be a friend to be a housewife.
True. I can barely take care of myself. I don't know what I would do with a puppy or baby.
You need to get a proper job.
That's what everyone tells me. Governments, family, friends, lovers. Do you know a woman once commented that I look like a younger version of the Mona Lisa? Do you think in a past life I could have actually been the face of Mona Lisa, and now my face is with millions?
If you believe in past lives.
Maybe you were a famous artist in Paris or Rome, and you were commissioned to paint the Mona Lisa.
Potato, Valentina.
Maybe you and I were lovers in a past life, and you fell in love with my nude body.
You're not my type. I like my women plump and rounded. Ribbonesque.
Fitness gyms will go extinct at this rate. Going back to eyesight, do you know in the movie Slumdog Millionaire, the blind boy tells the boy who can see what's on a US $100 bill? That's what I think of most artists. They look, but they don't actually see the model and her beauty, so they might as well be blind.
Look at the positive side. Maybe your face in this lifetime might make more than $100, maybe millions.
If I could grace the cover of Vogue.
Playboy would be good.
Yes, their photography is beautiful. Do you know I've mostly been approached by women to model for nude photography?
Women love the beauty of a female body, more than they like to admit. Do you enjoy being naked?
Not really, it's a job. Actually, I prefer to have some clothes on than being fully naked. Sometimes when I model and I add a few stockings and high heels, suddenly it makes me look more erotic, and it makes the artist really nervous, especially the dowdy Canadian women. And so suddenly adding more clothes on becomes more erotic than being fully naked. Funny how that is. I guess it's the elements of what you hide is what makes a woman more erotic or sexual than showing everything. Like Basic Instinct, she showed a snippet of nudity and everyone went crazy.
What made you start to model?
I don't know. I fell into it. It's almost spiritual. Like I'm supposed to be naked making money, even though I'm an actress and I do speak. It takes a lot of courage to model nude in front of 40 students or artists. When you model nude, you have nothing to hide from. You just have yourself. We were born naked, we die naked. We don't take our clothes with us. From dust to dust, from dust to dust. What's wrong? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
So also written and directed by you.
Yes, and produced.
clearly. So what was the statement you were looking to make with that piece?
I just tied it into a story about past lives, but I guess it's questions that I've, as a model, for example, yes, they do draw me with lots of fat and love handles. Mm-hmm. Most artists do that. I don't know why.
They project, why do you think that is?
Because, like you said, they project themselves on the paper.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like I was explaining, they look but they don't actually see
mm-hmm.
the model.
Right. Do you think that's some sort of a simple way of interpreting art rather than being specific as compared to... I mean, if you were looking to do something and have it be exact and precise, well, you could always just take a picture.
Yes, I guess like a photograph or... Mm-hmm. I mean, I did say in there, artists should capture the essence of beauty, not sure. distort it. But, and I said, if they want a fat model, get a fat model. Right. So,
but then they're going, the canvas isn't big enough for my imagination. I just can't, the love handles keep going off the thing.
I know. So, but yeah, it was a really hard shoot. I mean, it was done quickly, like in an hour.
That'd be quick.
So, it was tough.
Mm-hmm. But you're proud of it.
I think
well,
I guess,
am. Are you proud of it?
I am, and I think that from showing it to friends and people,
mm-hmm.
they seem to like this even more than my action films.
I was waiting for you to pull out a gun and just go, paint it right!
Oh, by the way, you haven't seen Eye of the Empress 2 where there's a rat?
Well, we're going to get to that.
And more fights, okay.
Oh, no, I've seen it. I just, I very specifically chose not to show the whole thing, so you could go find it on YouTube and check it out for yourself.
And there's even more guys.
Oh, yeah, no, it's really cool. It's, again, it's very, it's like, to me, I was watching going, this is Kill Bill's younger niece.
That's, okay.
But just to before we get to the rat.
Okay.
I guess what made you want to shoot that? Because I feel like there's something. I mean, there. It feels like there's a heart. There's some sort of guts to that, and I'm trying to figure out exactly what it is. What did it mean to you? Because there's something very heartfelt about it, and so I'm wondering what. Do we need a couch? We can go back to the therapy thing. Tell me, Sanjini.
I think it's...
How does this relate to your father?
In Canada, you know, I was having a difficult time.
Yeah.
As far as I had agents and just working as an actress, I'm too exotic and spicy for that culture.
Mm-hmm. Like so, Indian food.
Yes, yes. So I found that was something I just fell into and something that they kept hiring me to do. Mm-hmm. At the colleges and community centers, is getting checks from the government, like West Vancouver district,
mm-hmm.
for being naked. There was also like one, a couple classes where, whether it was photography or art, it was sometimes it was another model,
mm-hmm.
sometimes a woman, but so men, where I'm modeling with a guy, and one time I'm pretending to paint the guy, and I'm thinking, I'm in a college and I'm getting paid to do this. And we naked. It's so funny. So.
Was that an experience that you enjoyed? Or was it... sometimes it sounds like you thought it was great. And sometimes it sounds like you're like, this is really stupid.
No. Because being in the art world is still creative
mm-hmm.
for an artist. You're an artist too.
Yes.
You know, musician. Frequently. So whether it's music, whether it's film, video game industry, animation... art, it's like they're all, you know, fashion, they blend, or they, sometimes they overlap.
Mm-hmm.
And the art world, for centuries and for like thousands of years, it's like you'd be surprised how many artists are, they're very cultured, they've traveled the world, many. They sometimes very wealthy.
Mm-hmm. That's
producers' wives.
So it's very small sometimes on the very wealthy.
Yes, yes. but what I'm saying is, the art world is billionaires invest in art.
Mm-hmm.
So you
really?
Need, yes, they do. They do. A lot of them. So, it's still creative. And mm-hmm. and then I got to have Canadian people that had to stare at me for 3 or 4 hours.
Okay.
They didn't want to stare at me, they had to.
And that bothered you, clearly.
No, I like
it. Yeah, exactly. That's, yeah.
And I'm on stage and I'm like, okay, draw me. But most of the time I'm not actually in that one position.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if it's animation students or people in the video game industry, it's a lot of gestures. So every 45 seconds or a minute or 2 minutes, you have to move.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a lot more dynamic poses.
Gotcha.
And I actually like the longer ones because I get to fantasize and just, you know, relax and go into my own world.
Mm-hmm.
And just but you do take breaks.
Mm-hmm.
Like people think you sit there for like 4 hours. You take like breaks after every 25 minutes. Yeah. So, yeah.
Smoke break, gotta breathe.
And then when you take a break, there's like tea or sometimes snacks, mm-hmm. or the artists come and speak to you, and they're very, very appreciative. So it's not like being a stripper, because it's, mm-hmm. it's actually not very sexual.
I was going to say, if you were sitting up there to be, and the artist came up and like threw $1 bills at you, that would be kind of weird.
Yes, that would be.
Yeah.
I've been in like a college where it was the end of semester, and these kids are falling asleep, and I'm thinking, I'm naked, and you're falling asleep.
And you're sleeping? Oh.
Yes. And, but they
wake up!
It.
Look at me!
But it's mostly geeks who have drawn me.
Right?
Yeah.
So we are actually just about to run out of time, and I wanted to touch on the rat without giving away anything that goes on in Eye of the Empress Part 2. It's got some great stuff with the rat. The rat's name was actually
Corbin Dallas.
Who is Bruce Willis's character from The Fifth Element. I thought that was an amazingly talented rat at that.
Oh,
so
yes.
Because we're running out of time, where can people find your work? Obviously, the kids' books are available on Amazon. What about your other...
iTunes.
And iTunes.
They can find like my work on YouTube, my channel, Sanjini Actress, or just look up Eye of the Empress.
Eye of the Empress, just like it sounds.
And you'll find my channel.
And it's really cool. It's a great watch. It really is. It's a good time.
Yes, it is. It's got everything from children's books to the art model film action.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for tuning in to this episode of The Brian Crow Show. Tune in next week when something else will happen. And I don't know what yet. And thank you, Sanjini, so much for taking time and sharing yourself with us.
Thank you.
And take care. Drive dangerously. Take risks. See ya.
This is the KXSR Digital Broadcast Network.